All right, so good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
All right, so I'd like to start with introductions, introduce myself. I'm Lisa Morris. I'm from Honeywell. I'm the product line director for the TPE 331 engine, so that's the turboprop engine from Honeywell. And I'd like to introduce Bobby.
I think I know about half of you in here because we've met at one time or another. So.
Yep, so we'll be splitting up the presentation today. I'm going to go through some of the history and information about the engine itself. And then Bobby will go through its uses in skydiving, so you get a little bit more of a feel for the application. Okay. Any questions along the way, go ahead and shoot them out, and do our best to answer. Oops. All right, so this is a bit about the engine itself. It's been around for 50 years, so the first certification with the FAA happened in 1965. We've got a nice range from a shaft horsepower standpoint. So it starts around 575 horsepower, and it goes up to 1650. This engine was originally designed for regional airlines. So from a maintenance standpoint, robustness standpoint, you'll find in our gearbox, it's suited towards the higher shaft horsepower range for the turboprop engine. About 125 million service hours, and we'll show a bit of a breakdown of that so you can see how that lands on some of the ranges of the horsepower out there. And again, about 40 plus corporate and regional aircraft applications. We've done a real nice job, and we'll show some detail regarding maintenance. So from an AIN standpoint, we get ranked number one for our maintenance and service of the engine and warranty of the engine. So it's nice to have that, and it's not just a one-time thing. We've been ranked number one for the past 5 years straight, and out of the last 7 years, six out of the last 7 years been number one. All right, see, these are some of the applications. I realize some of them are a bit hard to see from the back, and we'll show you a little bit more detail. So I'll highlight some of the ones that you may be familiar with. The ones with the black border are in current production. So the Reaper or Predator, this is the UAV drone that you hear about in the news quite a bit. We power the drone. This is the Texas Turbine Caravan conversion. The Dornier 228, built by RUAG. It's also built by HAL in India. The Casa 212 is currently being built in Indonesia. That was originally an Airbus aircraft. And the S2 Turbo Tracker. So the S2 is the large block engine. Do a lot of firefighting applications with that aircraft. As well as this is one that we do a carrier land on in Brazil and Argentina. Okay. So quite a few out there that are recognizable with the engine. This gives a little bit more about the engine models. So back in 1965, it started with a -1, -2 engine. And so you'll see those in the series 1, 2. You'll hear -5, -6, -8. So a lot of different variations as the engine grew up over time. And so you'll see the majority of the fleet hours are there because you've got about 40 years of those engines being out and being the main production engines. Today we've got two main engines, a small and a large block. Small block is termed as a -10, -12. And they typically relate to horsepower. So when you go to, in the early series, those are anywhere from the 575 to about 800 horsepower. The small block here is around 1,100 horsepower, and so it's typically flat rated for the application. The one in the Texas Turbine Caravan is a 900, and we'll be coming out with a 950 shaft horsepower here shortly. The large block goes up to 1650, and the large block is kind of a unique engine. It has the gearbox to go up to 1650. We've also run that engine upwards of 55,000 feet. If you've heard of the Egret, it looks like a kind of a combination aircraft glider, but it can go up that high. And then some of the endurance that you hear of on the small block. So the small block in that Predator Reaper is a -10 engine, and it can run continuously for 32 hours. So it's kind of unique in that way from a loiter standpoint. It does quite well, and it comes down to the efficiency of the engine that allows for some of that. Right, here's some of the aircraft. I know those pictures were small, so we kind of laid out so you can see the current production and of the two main engines, the small and the large block applications. So there's, you'll see a lot of military agriculture aircraft. One of the nice features about the turboprop, and we'll go through why that is, but it's got a single shaft, so you've got a nice throttle response. It's an instant throttle response. So you see individuals that are running military turboprop trainers, as well as agriculture, they want the power right then. They don't want the engine to spool up. So for instance, if you're in an agriculture operation and you're dusting a field, and you're coming up on a corner and you've got wires or something that's in your way and you want to get out now, it's got the instant power. It's not a give the throttle and count to three and get your power. So they like it from a maneuverability standpoint, as well as the military trainers also appreciate that when they're going up through the ranks and learning to be military pilots and going into jets. It kind of has that jet feel with that throttle response. Some of the technical strengths. So I'm not going to pull any details or expect any engineers in the room to to come up with some of these numbers, but it kind of gives some of the ranges. And you can see the different models, and we've lined up some of the production aircraft. So you can see what their dry weight is and the prop RPM, as well as some of the intervals for the hot section and time before overhaul. So these down here is some of the key numbers. Because you can run for quite a few more hours before you have those large maintenance events that are your most costly events. And you want that amount of time so that you can spread out that cost while you're running. Okay. These are when we talk about turboprops in general, there's two basic types of turboprops. There's a dual shaft and a single shaft. And the dual shaft is typically what's called a reverse flow. And the single shaft is a straight through-flow engine. And so Pratt, Whitney, GE probably are also familiar with from a turboprop or turbo machinery standpoint. Those are both designs are the same. They're two-shaft reverse-flow engines versus what you'll see as a single shaft. The only other single shaft that's out there, but it's quite a bit less horsepower, and the design is old. It hasn't been updated as much as the Allison engine from Rolls-Royce. Similar construction in that it's got the single shaft. So two basic categories. And so I wanted to spend some time to talk about the technology there and why you'll see the differences and how they interact. So first and foremost, when you look at the two engines, there's quite a few more components that you see in a two-spool reverse flow engine. It's basically got two gearboxes or two transmissions within it to handle those two shafts. Whereas in the single shaft engine, you've got the one gearbox that's translating the power to the propeller. And again, that's more of a step down to be able to make the RPM for the propeller different from the RPM of the engine for tip speed, et cetera, to run the engine. When you look at the flow of the engine, on a single spool flow through engine, the inlet comes in straight from the front. So the nice thing about it is when you do an install of this engine on aircraft, there's not a whole lot of claptrap or ducting, et cetera, to get the air where you need it to be. It comes straight into the engine. We've got a dual centrifugal compressor, and this is kind of a unique design from Honeywell. So it was originally by Garrett. Garrett Engines, if you're familiar with Garrett Turbos. So same company, same engineering work at the beginning. But that core, core compressor with the centrifugal first stage, they're large, robust, and they're able to handle FOD coming in the front of the engine. Whereas on a reverse flow, two things are happening. One, you've got to bring the flow in through the back of the engine, so you'll see a lot of duct work inside the install of an engine to get the air back in the back, as well as when you've got a FOD situation. So a FOD, foreign object debris, so the most common is icing. So when you've got an icing situation with this flow-through engine, you'll lose about 4% pulling bleed air off the engine, so hot air off the engine to run your de-icing system. In a two-stage or a two-spool engine, you've actually got a bypass duct. So you've got to open up the bypass duct to let the ice out so that it doesn't damage your axial compressors here. And when you do that, you lose about 12%. So from an efficiency standpoint, if you're running into icing or you've got issues where you've got debris, so you're coming off of a dirt lot, et cetera, this engine's more able to help handle it without losing power. The other big differences you'll see is with those components, with the three axial compressors back here, when you go to do a hot section, which is doing your maintenance on the main area back here in the core of the engine, you'll see a lot more cost because you've got to replace those blades on a routine basis. It's part of the hot section, part of the overhaul, is to inspect and go through those blades. We rarely, if ever, see a compressor come out of the flow-through engine. So from a cost standpoint, it makes sense. The other thing is when you've got less parts, there's less things to fix. So less parts, less components, less things that can break. It keeps it very simple. So it's a simple architecture. And that was one of the design constraints early on when dealing with regional aircraft. You lose time, downtime for doing the maintenance, the cost of doing the maintenance, and then from an efficiency standpoint, you want to be as high as possible because that's how you're making your money during the regional aircraft. And so that's translated to all of our applications for the engine going forward. I think those are probably the biggest highlights. Anything I missed? Okay. All right. You'll see some of these are highlighted and it's more picture-based. You'll see an accessory gearbox on the very end here. The accessory gearbox, the accessories are connected on that offset gearbox up front as well. So both of them have those. Okay. So some of the advantages of the engine. So the faster throttle response, again, it's a single shaft. So if the shaft is moving in the engine, your propeller's moving and you're getting the power. And there's no translation between the two. So there's no spool up time. You'll hear about spool up time and you can hear the engine going before you actually feel the aircraft going. You don't get that with the TPE. You hit the throttle, you get movement. So it's instant there. Better fuel efficiency, so there's a higher pressure ratio within the engine. So the hotter you run a turbo machinery, the better you have from an efficiency standpoint, and we're able to do that with the engine design. Lower cost of maintenance, again, it goes through both fuel efficiency from a specific fuel consumption, as well as the maintenance costs. And when we compared the two, we went to Conklin and to Decker to get a third-party look at all of our maintenance costs, comparing two shafts to a single shaft. And the difference from an hourly standpoint, it's about $55 an hour from a maintenance standpoint on a single shaft. And on the dual, it's roughly $88 an hour when you're looking at both fuel and maintenance costs. So it gives some nice efficiency numbers when you're looking at making decisions on what piece of equipment to put into the aircraft. Quiet or flyover. So a lot of the things that are noted about the TPE, because it's got the inlet behind the propeller, when you're on the ground, you can hear it. You can hear the difference between a TPE and a single shaft, whether it's or a dual shaft, whether it's a GE or a Pratt. As soon as it gets into the air, it's much, much quieter, and we've been able to pass all of the German regulations for noise, for flyover noise. So what that means is if you're operating the TPE, you're able to fly over areas and at different times without restriction, which is very important, particularly in Europe. Higher gearbox rating, so again, that gearbox is built for a higher threshold for the regional airline, so that's a nice feature that remains. And it's allowed us over time to increase the power availability, so basically your power to weight ratio has gotten much better over time as we've increased the technology in the engine. Single exhaust, this is a big deal when you're thinking about loading passengers into, a caravan, where you can have that single exhaust. So typically you'll see in a reverse flow engine, you can tell looking behind the propeller, you'll see the two, it looks like a ram's horns coming out with the two exhausts, which means either side of that aircraft that you're entering on, you're going to get that exhaust. Or you're going to have losses because you've got to pull that exhaust from one side and duct it over to the other side. With the TPE, there's a single exhaust coming out the back, so you're able to put that on the opposite side of the aircraft from where passengers load, so they never get a face full of exhaust when they're either, in your case, is jumping out of the airplane or entering the airplane that's on the ground. Simple to operate, so automatic one start button. You know, typically, you don't see that until you get into electronic controls. So some of the more advanced engines that are just coming out today with FADEX or electronic engine controls have a push-button start. We've had a push-button start since 1965. So that's always been part of the package. We are, however, also going to, we've got several models with electronic controls today, and we're going to a FADEC controller. So it's a fully digital system. And the advantages of going to that fully digital system is you can pull information off of the engine and you can do on condition maintenance. So without that technology of knowing what's happening in the engine, you do everything by intervals, regardless of whether your engine needs it or not. And this will translate us to only doing that when you need it. And so you can get a better feel and control some of your maintenance costs based on that. We talked a bit about the inlet particle separator. So there's no bypass door that has to open to separate that. That's not an issue with the engine. We have, for the record, we have eaten quite a few birds. Everybody does it. The nice thing is you get a check of the engine, and typically those compressors come right back and restored. It's not a replacement issue. If you do that with the axial compressors, you're replacing you're replacing those blades, and that's not a small cost item. Clean installation. So when you look at the offset on the gearbox, and as well as where all of the other LRUs are placed, they're easy to get to. They're not buried in the engine, and because you don't have all of that ductwork around the engine itself, you don't have to get through it to access the engine or access the LRUs. So it's not remove all the ductwork to get into the LRUs, it just goes straight in. So it's nice and open. Okay. So a bit about the service. So this is a very important part, and we've hit the top of this, and the nice thing, I pulled this from the October 16th issue because we were quite proud of it, that we were able to beat not only in the top overall score, but this year we hit it in every single category across the board. So that's, you know, when we think about our engine, it's more of a hot rod engine. So individuals that care about the performance of the machinery, that they're looking for something that's simple, that's not going to break, that's going to carry its weight, that's going to carry its service for years to come. We've got operators that have been running engines for 30 years, same engine. And they love that engine. And it's a bit like a fancy old car that you want to keep that up and keep that running in a hot rod sense. And this carries the same weight with that. And we've done really well across all of the categories with the customers being happy with the performance and the costs. And then the authorized channel partners. So you'll notice a lot, turboprops are fairly centric to North America. So you'll see a lot of our service centers there because that's where you see a lot of that business. We do have quite a bit in Europe. The green dots that you'll see are line service areas, so they can replace LRUs and do basic maintenance and then ship out the engine for overhauls, where in many cases we have rental banks available and the like so that the operator doesn't lose time. And then we've got some large overhaul shops, both Madrid, Denmark, and then we've also got one in...
Are you, which one are you talking about? Madrid, and then you had Denmark?
And you use another one for...
Oh, Smith's in Belgium.
In Belgium, yeah. In Belgium, where we do a lot of the work. So we're looking at, today, how the turboprops, the TPE, is focused and got a foothold in Europe. And just recently, the UK government, the RAF, purchased 25 of the drones. So we've got quite a bit more of the influx of TPE. So we're looking at Britain in general to say, okay, do we need another overhaul shop here to service the customers and make sure that they don't have to go to extents to get the work done on the engine. But we are worldwide, and you'll see a lot from a skydiving standpoint. So North America, Europe, and certainly in Australia, quite a bit of the TPEs running. All right, so from here I'm going to hand it over to Bobby. He's going to talk a bit about the history and how he's determined his application from a skydiving standpoint. Is there any questions along the way about the operation of the engine, maybe the differences from the two architectures and the like? Okay.
I have a loud mouth, at least that's what my wife says. So first off, how many people in here are pilots, I guess? So we get a range of So we have pilots on this, everybody, all the pilots on this side, no. And then we, how many skydivers we got? That's a good range, okay. How many DZ owners? There you go, all right. The lone DZ, we had a lone DZ owner, or was there Ian the only one? Oh, there's James. James was hiding in the back there, okay. Let's see, who else did we have? Oh, how many had a beer today yet? Oh, come on, there's got to be more than that, because I saw a lot of beer out there, so just want to make sure if everybody's awake. Thanks, Lisa, you did a good job on that, on the description there. I know it's, a lot of you guys have questions. What I want to do is I'll give you a little bit of the background of what, I guess where I came from both the TPE world and then also from skydiving. So the way I grew up in a flying family. My mother, my father both were pilots. My brother, my sister both fly. I went to college close to where I grew up, and I was working on airplanes, radial engines, and then went into flying skydivers actually for a while. So I did my first, through all the flying, I ended up with an ATP pilot's license. I got a mechanics license and an IA for inspection authorization for maintenance. And then I also have an electrical engineering degree. So I tried to cover the field. So the big thing that we did though was, I think my first time to actually jump out of a perfectly not so good airplane was in, I think 1990, about 20 years old. And I jumped out of a 182 doing a static line that my dad's good buddy packed the parachute for me, and that was my first and only malfunction, was on my first static line jump. And it was ironically enough for a square, I don't know how you can do it, but I ended up with a Mae West. I had a line right over the middle of it on a static line jump. And I remember when I did my classroom training, typical skydiving style, is I was putting an exhaust on a Cessna 182, and the guy's showing me pictures. If it looks like this, do this. If it looks like that, do that. And so when the parachute opened, I looked up at it and I was like, what the hell is this? This is not at all what the pictures that he showed me. You know, he says, well, okay, everything you do, pull the brakes, pump it down, you know, stuck slider, kick out a line twist, all this. So I pull on one toggle and the thing just goes into a spin. And then, so being the pilot that I am, I'm going, well, I'm at 3,800 feet. I got time to play with this, you know? So I start pulling on one side, it just flares. I pull on the other side, it spins down to like three times in about 2 seconds. I said, I don't want to do that again. So finally at 2,000 feet, cut away, go back into free fall. And I remembered looking, that's right where I'm going to hit, right there. And then all of a sudden the reserve opened and it's a 24-foot round. And so I stood up my only round jump because I was going to get drug across asphalt, so I thought it might be smart. But anyway, so I did we flew the 182s at the one drop zone, and then I moved off to my dad's drop zone that we started shortly after that, and we started 182s, and then we went into DC-3s and Caribous, and then we kept blowing up radial engines. And after about the sixth engine failure on a radial engine, my dad decides, you know what, I'm going to take the leap and buy a turbine engine. And so what he did is he bought a Garrett-powered Porter. So it was an old 1966 Porter from Air America, an old Vietnam Air America Porter. And we bought it from a guy up in New Jersey. Well, this engine, we knew nothing about it. I mean, I'd never flown a turboprop. My dad flew jet engines, but he never flew a turboprop. So we go up, and like Lisa was saying, the 331 has always had one button starting. So we get in there, he's reading through the checklist. The guy that owned the airplane had passed away, and his family was selling the airplane off. So there was nobody to teach us how to fly it. So he's reading through the checklist and he hits this button, and all of a sudden the thing starts spinning up and spins up at 10%. It turns the fuel and ignition on, it lights off, it comes to idle, and we he's just sitting here going, well, I guess it's running, I don't know, you know. So he goes out, does three touch and goes, and we're now the proud owners of a Garrett powered Porter. So that was the extent of the training on that. And then we flew it from New Jersey back to Texas that night, 13 hours home at a blazing 90 knots against a headwind. And of course, typical drop zone. We land as the sun's coming up about 6:37 in the morning, and the drop zone, everybody had slept there the night before. And what do? They could hear it coming in, so they're all coming out, and they're ready to go. They're ready to go skydiving. My dad and I are ready to go to bed, you know. But so anyway, we took it on. We started flying. We had a pre-century engine in it, which is actually even earlier than what Lisa had talked about. It's a 575 horsepower engine. The pre-centuries were originally, they were originally built as throwaway engines. So for the military, so they were actually only 2,000 hour engines, and they were moderately reliable, about like a Dash 6 PT6. They just were built to make a little bit of power and not last a long time. So what we did is we ran it for about a year or so, and we had some engine issues. We had some fuel control issues, whatever. We decided it's time to upgrade to a Dash 1, which is the same engine that's in a Peacemaker Porter, which is the ones that the Thai Air Force, they still fly them today. So we got a Dash 1 overhauled engine, put it in there, and it turned the airplane into a whole different airplane. We went from 2 loads an hour, burning about 18 gallons a load in a Porter with 9 jumpers, to about 4 loads an hour, burning about 12 to 14 gallons a load. So that was our first taste of what engine conversions could do for airplanes. And, you know, so then as we went on, we, as a drop zone, we were growing and growing, and we were thinking, hey, this would be great if we could increase capacity. We grew up to the point we were running 35 loads a day, 36 loads a day. And at the end of the day, when the sun goes down, we never shut down, and we'd still have 5 or 6 loads manifested. And we said, it's time to upgrade, which is what all the drop zones are saying. Hey, it's time to move up to something bigger. So we started looking at the Twin Otters, the Sky Vans. We leased multiple airplanes for several months to see what would happen. And the big challenge for us was always going from a 9-passenger airplane to a 20 or 24 passenger airplane and trying to keep the airplane going. So when it came down to it, we said, you know, what we really need is a bigger Porter, you know, something that's maybe twice the capacity, but still this single engine application that would help keep the cost down. So what we did is my dad, he says, hey, how about a single otter? And I'm like, single otter? I didn't even know what a single otter was. You know, I was 21 years old or 22 years old. So we go look at it. And of course, a single otter is the predecessor to the twin otter. It's a tail dragger. So we go get this fancy idea that we're going to take this airplane, convert it, and sell tons of them in skydiving. So in my infinite wisdom, we take and we put a Dash 10 331 on it, which is same thing, it's a 900 horsepower engine, so we rated it 900 takeoff, 900 continuous. And I thought if we make an STC, do an STC on it, even if we don't ever sell it again, we'll be able to use it at our own drop zone. Well, we converted it. I never sold another one in skydiving, but I sold 50 of them up into Canada and Alaska because it was a great bush airplane. It was a difficult airplane. It's about probably 3 times harder to fly than a Porter is, especially in a crosswind. So that's what really didn't make it conducive to skydiving, because you couldn't find pilots to fly it. But the interesting thing is it proved the concept, though, of another single-engine turboprop airplane that's bigger, that's still efficient. Because we could now carry, where we had 9 skydivers in a Porter with 12 to 14 gallons of load, we were now 18 skydivers with about 18 gallons of load. So it only cost us a little bit of gas to carry twice as many, and we were doing it just as fast. And so then how we came into the Caravan was the same thing. I looked at it, the radial engine Otter was a 600 horse engine. We moved up to 900 horsepower. It was an 8,000 pound airplane. You know, it worked out well. The natural next step was to go to the Caravan. So what we did is we looked at the Caravan and said, I can re-engine this in a similar engine. So we looked at the Dash 10 and the Dash 12, and after all the choices from maintenance costs, fuel burns, and all the other stuff, we said, we're going to choose the Dash 12. It's the latest engine. It has aluminum gearbox instead of a magnesium gearbox. It's got strain gauge torque systems, all these new neat things that are in it. And so we certified that. We certified it on three different models, both the short body, the Grand, and the Amphibian, which took a mere 5 years to do. So when you ask why is it so expensive, it's because it takes 5 years of certification to get it all done. But since that time, it turned it into the Caravans as they exist now. They're about a 12 minutes to altitude type airplane, carrying 18, 19 skydivers, and they burn, I say about a gallon a jumper, but conservatively, that's a conservative number. And so when you look at that in comparison to some of the twin engine applications in the skydiving market, it actually is probably the most efficient airplane out there that gives you the most growth one way or the other. And that's the neat part about the engine is that you could operate the airplane with 8 skydivers, and this is not supposed to be a sales pitch. I'm talking about it from a drop zone owner or from pilots that are saying, hey, what can we do? Because you can take a Caravan and put 8 skydivers in it and still make money with these. Whereas if you take a Twin Otter and you put 8 people in it, you're not going to do it for very long. So, and then as opposed to a Porter, you could carry 9 skydivers in it, but the operational costs are almost the same as a Caravan. So the nice thing about a Caravan is it has the large cabin. It just never had the power with a 675 to really meet the high demand of busy drop zones. So what happened with this is we ended up with an airplane that kind of gave them the best of both worlds. It gave them a Twin Otter lift capacity with a fuel burn of the Pilatus Porter, and then it's an easy airplane to fly. So it's really from a skydiving standpoint, I think the market both in the US and really worldwide is probably tending toward single engine airplanes just because of the operational costs, the fuel burns. Fuel's never getting any, fuel's doing nothing but going up. The engine parts, they're just getting more expensive. So really from a long-term standpoint, I think you're gonna see most of the drop zones, both US, Europe, and Australia, they're all going to single engine applications rather than twin engine. And the 331 makes a perfect match on the Caravan. So I don't know if there's, it was just a little bit of history. Hope it didn't bore you from my side of it. But if you guys have any questions about the engine as far as the history or the operation or things that pilots might like, not like. You all good? Where are we time-wise? I don't even know. I left my... Oh, you got a video, don't you? Mm-hmm. I got another video. If all else fails, you get to watch another skydiving video.
We've got about 20 minutes. Yeah, so I'd never changed it from Phoenix time.
Oh.
And I'm from Phoenix. Phoenix is where we manufacture the engines. Phoenix, Arizona, so out in the desert. So all this wet weather and the cold has been a nice treat. We appreciate that.
A treat?
I'll go back saying, hey, I saw rain.
We have there's a video here, and she'll run a couple others if you guys want to see them. There's, it's just more of the drop zones around. It's not, if you want to see it, you're more than welcome to hang out. It's about 4 or 5 minutes, but... Lisa was talking about some of the, she said maybe I want to mention some of the records they had done with the airplane. I know the guys in Europe, they had put, I think they did, I'm not sure, anybody here know what the big way they did in Europe? What they had six super vans running or seven super vans there? I think it was a, what's that?
It was in Germany, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think, I don't know if it was.
Six or seven super vans.
Yeah, they, I don't know, they ended up doing 100 and, 100, was it 120? No, it would have been about 100 and, I don't know, I'm not sure. The most impressive one to me from a performance standpoint was Ray Farrell's out in Davis, California. They did a, they were doing high altitude jumps and they did a wingsuit jump from, it was 37,500 feet out of a super van. And they said that they had, I think he said they had six or eight people in the airplane and they made it to 37.5 and it was about 45 minutes. So obviously they were carrying light fuel and all that. But the crazy thing was, is the guy, when he jumped out, he had a GoPro facing backwards on his helmet. And when he goes out with the wingsuit, you see the caravan flying off and it's got contrails coming off the exhaust. And he, and Ray said that his altimeter froze at 35,000 feet. It just stopped moving because so they actually used the telemetry stuff or whatever, I guess, to figure out the exact altitude. But I think it was one of the, I think the guy has the wingsuit record for the highest altitude jump. And I don't know how many, they had all the specs on how many miles he covered, how long the free fall was. It was a pretty impressive deal, but there's guys that are flying them all over the world right now, doing all kinds of crazy things. So I think you'll see some more around here, and the 331, it'll continue to grow into skydiving. The interesting thing too, most of the people's experience with the Garretts in skydiving have been with the Skyvans, and so one important note to know. It's the difference between a Skyvan and the Dash 12 engine is that they're pretty significantly different. I mean, they both look the same, but the gearbox, the RPM that the engine runs, the Skyvan has a 2,000 RPM propeller shaft. So when you hear those, they're really noisy on the ground because there's two engines running and they're both running 2,000 RPMs at the high speed. Where these, the Dash 12s are 1,591 RPM. So what it does is it significantly lowers the flyover noise level and you know, from a takeoff and during the climb out and the descents. And so that's what's really helped us out as far as noise. The other thing is the actual turbine wheels, the rotating group in the engine, it's quite a bit different. So the Skyvan engine had solid turbine discs, the first, second, and third stage. And so if they had a crack in a blade, you basically had to throw the whole disc away, which gets real expensive over time. And so what the Honeywell did, or Garrett at the time, they ended up putting a rebladable first stage and a rebladable second stage in, so that if you ended up having a crack in the blade, you could replace just the blade and then move on. And then the third stage is still a blisk, but they didn't really have much issues with that one. So the torque system's different. So a lot of the things, if you look at it from a history and skydiving standpoint, a lot of the things that were issues with the Skyvan and the Dash 2s are not necessarily issues with the 331s of now and in the Caravan. So these engines are closer related to the CASA 212 200 series engines. So if you've happened to been around an operation that was running a 200, two or 300. So anything else? You guys got any questions? I know it's getting hot in here. So, well, thank you for coming. We appreciate it. We'll hang around. If anybody has any questions, step up here, holler at us, or feel free to stop by the booth.